يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد الله عز وجل He said in the Quran كتاب أعوذ بالله من بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياته وليتذكر أولو الألباب He said عز وجل What can be translated as Surely this is the book which we have revealed and sent down upon you so that you may ponder over it and reflect on the meanings of this book and its verses, and so that the people of intellect may reflect and draw lessons from this Qur'an that has been revealed. And this Qur'an, which Allah Azza wa Jal sent as a guidance and a revelation and as a light, it is not hidden from us the importance of this Qur'an. As Allah Azza wa Jal He mentioned that this Qur'an is a light and a nur. And he also mentioned that this Qur'an is a mercy to mankind. And he Azza wa Jal also mentioned that this Qur'an يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ وَيُبَشِّرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَيُبَشِّرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَبِيرًا That this Qur'an, it guides the believers. And it is a glad tidings. And a revelation and a mercy for the believers. It takes them out of darkness to light. And it takes them from ignorance to knowledge. And it guides them ultimately to Jannah and saves them from the hellfire. And there's just one hadith which shows us the importance of this Qur'an and the power of this Qur'an in how it can completely change the person's life. And that's the hadith reported by Imam Ahmad on the authority of Ibn Mas'ud. The dua which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised all his companions to memorize. And that is the dua where we ask Allah Azza wa Jal, after asking him through his names and his attributes, asking him by all the names which he knows, and those names which the creation know, and those names of Allah which the creation doesn't know, and those names of Allah Azza wa Jal which he has kept to himself. We say after all of this, that we ask Allah to make the Qur'an the spring of our hearts, and the dispeller of our worries, and the remover of our sadness. Then the companions, they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, should we memorize this hadith? Should we memorize this dua? Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, you should memorize this dua. Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, that when Allah revealed the Zabur, and the Torah, and the Injil, he summarized these books, into the Qur'an. And he summarized the Qur'an into the Fatiha. And as a result of the importance of the Fatiha and its meanings, today we'll take a short glimpse and a small glimpse into the meanings of the surah and the gems within the surah and the benefits and the virtues of the surah. When one of us stands in front of Allah Azza wa Jal and he or she starts with the takbirah and says Allahu Akbar, The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described to us what takes place after the takbir. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when one of you stands in front of Allah Azza wa Jal and says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, Hamidani Abdi, that my slave has praised me. And then when you say, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, the most beneficent, then Allah Azza wa Jal says, Athna alayya Abdi, that my slave has exalted me. Then you say, Maliki Yawmiddin, the owner and the king of the day of judgment. Then Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, Majjadani Abdi, my slave has glorified me. So the first ayah, when we praise Allah Azza wa Jal, we praise Him as He is the Lord and the maintainer and the creator and the sustainer of this universe and everything within this universe. So we praise Him and we thank Him for the way that He has decreed whatever He has decreed, and that nothing happens without His decree. And we show and manifest our servitude and our destitution and our need and attachment to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this surah is a dua as mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we learn within it the adab and the mannerisms of making dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. And we begin as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw many of his companions who made dua without praising him. Then he said to them that, why are you hasty? And why don't you begin by praising Allah Azza wa Jal? So we begin by praising Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the benefits of praising Allah Azza wa Jal in our du'as generally can be taken from the hadith which we all know. After we rise from the ruku', we say, Sami' Allahu liman hamidah. That Allah Azza wa Jal hears those who praise Him. So it is a way to open the du'a. And so that Allah Azza wa Jal answers our du'a, and we have a greater chance for our du'as to be answered. Then the next verse, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, the most beneficent. We internalize the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah introduces Himself to us through His names and His attributes. And the mercy of Allah has been mentioned over and over again in the Quran and in the Sunnah. As Allah Azza wa Jal, He said in the Quran, Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, Allam al-Quran. Then He immediately said after that, the one who taught the Quran, showing us that this Quran is full of mercy, and it is mercy, and a mercy for mankind. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once, he saw a lady who was embracing a child after she lost the child, and she was frantically searching for her child. Then when she found her child, she clinged to the child and embraced the child. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stopped with his companions, pointing to the lady, and he said, do you think that this lady would ever throw her child into the fire? Then the companion said, no, O Messenger of Allah. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah's mercy is more expansive, and Allah's mercy is greater than this lady and her mercy to her child. So when we stand in front of Allah and we say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, we must internalize these meanings that are within the surah, the expansive nature of Allah's mercy. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said in another hadith that the mercy that exists on this worldly life, which forces the animal to raise its hoof and to turn it away from its child and not trampling it, this is one part out of 100 parts of the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. So all this mercy that we see existing in this worldly life between the humans and the animals, all of this is just one part of the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. So we must again keep these meanings in our heart and at the forefront of our minds when we are reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. Another benefit within the books of Tafaseer, which point to the meanings of the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, can be derived from the ayah where Allah Azza wa Jal says, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arshi istawa, that the most merciful, He rose over His throne. One of the Salaf, rahimahumullahu ta'ala, he said that Allah chose to mention this attribute and this name of His next to the greatest creation and the most expansive creation. So when Allah rose over the throne, He decided to introduce Himself to the creation and to claim and proclaim His name and attribute Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, showing us that the most expansive attribute of Allah is His mercy, and that His mercy encompasses everything. As Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. Then we move on to the next verse, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ, where Allah Azza wa Jal says, the owner and the king of the day of judgment. So the first part of the surah, our hearts will be filled with hope if we focus and if we pay attention, because we remember the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. Then the second part, we remember the day of judgment and the state of the creation and how they will be in chaos, and how the next will be choked with fear, and how the mother will run away from her child, and the brother will run away from his brother, and the father will abandon his children. يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه. Allah Azza wa Jal, He describes to us the state of the creation on the day of judgment, to the extent that the prophets will say, "Nafsi, nafsi." So we turn from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, and then we move to the punishment and the power and the ability of Allah Azza wa Jal. So we worship Allah between the two states of fear and hope. As the Salaf rahimahumullah ta'ala said many times, that our journey in this life to Allah Azza wa Jal is like that of a bird, that the bird has two wings. It has two wings, and so if one of it is cut, then the bird cannot continue his journey. So one of them is having hope in Allah Azza wa Jal, and the other is fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after we internalize these meanings, we move to the middle of the surah, where Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned in the surah, and we say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. That you alone we seek assistance from, you alone we worship, and you alone we seek assistance from. So the first part of this ayah, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, it follows the first part of the surah, where we thank Allah and praise Him and glorify Him and remember Him, and we focus on His remembrance, and that is worship. And the second part of the surah, which we'll cover in the second part of the khutbah, is the isti'ana and assistance that we take from Allah Azza wa Jal, and that we request from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the salaf of this ummah, they pointed to this verse to the extent that this verse has been explained in volumes literally. As one of the scholars, Ibn al-Qayyim, he spent volumes explaining this particular verse. Allah Azza wa Jal, He told us in the Quran that depending on your worship, that is the amount of assistance that you will receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah, He said, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِكَافٍ عَبْدَهُ. Isn't Allah sufficient for His slave? So al-kifaya has been attached to ibadah. And He also said in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبْ وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. So taqwa was mentioned first. Whoever fears Allah and is mindful of Allah, then Allah will take him out of every difficult situation. Then the isti'ana was mentioned, and the tawakkul, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. And whosoever puts their trust in Allah, then Allah is enough. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also advised his companion Abdullah ibn Abbas, احفظِ الله, be mindful of Allah. Keep Allah's boundaries safe and protect them in your mind and in your heart. What will be the result? احفظِ الله يحفظك. Then Allah will protect you, and He will guard you, and He will safeguard you and protect you. So we see in the first part of the surah the benefits and the virtues of the surah. And that's why one of the a'imma describing the surah, he said, and talking about the virtues of the Quran, هو الكلام الذي إذا قام العبد يقرأه كأنما خاطب الرحمن بالكلمة. This is the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal, that when the person stands and recites, then it's as if he's conversing directly with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's having a private and a one-to-one conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll inshallah discuss this, the second half of the khutbah, the second half of the Fatiha, in the second part of the khutbah. قولوا ما تسمعون استغفروا الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا إنه الغفور الرحيم. If the brothers could move up, as your brothers are in the back standing and waiting to find a space. So if you could move up, if you find a space in front of you. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddin, amma ba'd. After we say, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'een, we ask Allah and we enter into the request, as this surah is a dua and a request. And it is the greatest dua that someone can make. And that is when we say, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, that guide us to the straight path. Guide us to the straight path. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that the greatest karama is luzum al-istiqama. That the greatest honor that someone can be honored with is to remain steadfast and to hold on to this path until they pass away, and until they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we reflect on this verse, we see that this verse, if the person prays 5 times a day, then he repeats this dua 17 times a day. And there's a wisdom for this. And there's a reason why this dua is preceded by all this exaltation and glorification and thanking Allah and praising Him and showing Him that we need His mercy and that we are worshipping Him with hope and fear and love and sincerity. Then we come to this point where we ask Allah for istiqamah. And the reason for this, and the reason why we repeat this day in and day out so many times in a single day, is because of our utter need to this steadfastness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we claim and we proclaim with this verse, and we make it clear that istiqamah does not come from us, and that istiqamah comes from Allah. Because we say, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim, guide us to the straight path. Because if you're Muslim, then you can become a non-Muslim. And if you're a person of knowledge, then you can lose all of that knowledge. And if you're someone who is practicing and worshipping Allah and following the legislation of Allah, you could be someone who is going in the opposite direction tomorrow. You could be someone calling the people to Islam and reminding them, and then your heart can be changed all of a sudden, and your heart will turn harder than a stone. And this is not within our control. This is within the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we ask Allah, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Because even if we are guided with knowledge, then we need more knowledge. And even if we worship Allah, then we have not worshipped Allah enough. And even if we are guided and practicing, then we have mistakes and we have faults and defects in our istiqamah. So that's why we need to renew this dua over and over again. And if you look at the most steadfast of Allah's creation, starting from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the most frequent dua that he used to repeat was, Ya muqallib al-qulub thabbit qalbi ala dinik, O turner of the heart, and O the one who flips the heart, keep my heart steadfast on your religion. And when he was asked that why do you repeat this dua over and over again, he said, Inna al-qulub bayna usbu'ayn min asabi' al-Rahman, in sha'a an yuqimahu aqama, wa in sha'a an yuzighahu azagha. That indeed the hearts are in between the two fingers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If He wishes to keep them steadfast and straight and firm, then He keeps them firm. And if He wishes to misguide them, then He misguides them. And this is the nature of the heart. The heart is within Allah's hand subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the word qalb in the Arabic language means to turn and to flip and to change all the time. As that's why it's called qalb. Because يقلب وما سمي القلب قلبا إلا من تقلبه فاحذر على القلب من قلب وتقليبي. As one of them said, that the qalb was not called qalb, which literally means to turn, except because of its nature that it turns and flips and it changes without your control. فاحذر على القلب من قلب وتقليبي. So beware of your heart that it's overturned and that it changes while you're unaware. Ibrahim عليه السلام, who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was commanded to follow in his footsteps, he said, and he's the same one who built the Kaaba with his hands, and he's the same one who was there and ready about to sacrifice his son as a result of following the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim alayhi salam is the one who's thrown into the fire because of his tawheed, and he's the one who broke the idols with his own hands. And after all of this service for Allah's religion, and after reaching the state of khulla and becoming the khalil of the Rahman, the khalil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the dua which he made, which Allah recorded for us to follow in his footsteps, is Rabbi junubni wa baniya an na'bud al asnam. That, oh Allah, oh my Lord, take me and my sons far away from worshipping the idols. One of the Salaf, later on making tafsir of this verse, he said, wa man ya'manu al bala'a ba'daka ya Ibrahim. That after you, oh Ibrahim, who is safe and sound? Who is secure, and who can feel secure and safe after you, O Ibrahim? Because Ibrahim is the one who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was told to follow in his footsteps, and yet he makes his dua that take me junubni wa baniya an na'bud al asnam, that take me and my sons one side, and take shirk and idolatry far away on the other side. Don't bring us anywhere near each other. And this fear which takes hold of the awliya's hearts, this is the result why they attain success and they reach success. Because they never felt for a moment in their life that their position in Jannah is secured just because they have a Muslim name or they came from a Muslim household. And look today in this day and age. Look today in this day and age, you find many people who have left Islam and who have turned. They have not only left Islam, now they fight Islam. And they become famous by fighting Islam. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. And before they were Muslims. This is the result. Because this person, their heart was corrupt. And it was corrupt and full of filth and corruption. So we should always be in the state of fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not knowing our state. The Salaf rahimahumullah ta'ala and these countless events and narrations and statements which point to how much fear they had of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that the tawheed is removed. One of them is Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah ta'ala, one of the Salaf of this ummah. He was seen on his way to Hajj or on his way back from Hajj, crying and weeping until the people around him felt sorry for him. Then they said to him, "Are you crying? Are you crying as a result of your sins?" Then he held some dirt from the floor and some dust. And he said, "My sins to me is like this dirt in my hand. But what I truly fear, أَخَافُ أَنْ أُسْلَبَ التوحيد. I fear that tawheed is removed from my heart." And so the secret to success and the secret to attaining Jannah and to not die as a disbeliever is to continuously have this fear in your heart that you do not know where you're going to end and that your state is in Allah's hands subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah Azza wa Jal does not throw away His slaves, His sincere slaves, into the fire after they have made clear to Him how much they need Him and their attachment to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. After we say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, then we say, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. We ask Allah for the opposite. We ask Allah to guide us to the path of those He has bestowed, those who He has bestowed His bounties and blessings upon. And yet again, this verse emphasizes that this ni'mah comes from Allah, أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, those who you have blessed. So no one attains knowledge as a result of their own intelligence or their hard work. No one attains Jannah as a result of their worship. As the Prophet said, that even he doesn't attain Jannah except as the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one attains success except with the help of Allah. So then, we make this clear, أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, those who you have blessed from the prophets and the messengers and the martyrs and the righteous from this ummah. Then we move on to the last part of the surah where we ask Allah to protect us from the path of those who He has shown His anger to and those who were misled and misguided as a result of their ignorance. And the Prophet told us that there were people of the book of the past, the Jews and the Christians. As for the Jews, then they never used to act upon the knowledge, even though they were given much knowledge. And that's why Allah's wrath descended upon them. And as for the Christians, then they are those who just acted without knowledge. And that's why they became misguided. These are only some of the comments on this surah. And this is more of a reminder that we should turn to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that we should spend time reflecting and pondering over the Qur'an. As this Qur'an is a cure and a light and a mercy. And if we do not know the meanings of the Qur'an, then how can we attach and how can we draw near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We won't understand the Imam when he's reading Qur'an. And our hearts will not be enlightened. And we won't be able to benefit from this Qur'an. So if you memorize the Qur'an, it's not enough to stop. Then we have to reflect and read the tafsir and ponder over the meanings and reflect and deeply look into this message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وأقم الصلاة يرحمكم الله